Welcome, my sea devils and demons. This is Nurse Hatchet. You are listening to the Wolf Pack.
The horror genre is a great expanse. Let us explore it. I've spent years as a podcaster building my reputation, interviewing people in horror, and discussing both films and literary horror. Join the exploration and let us celebrate the horror genre. I'm William Pattison. And this is
Bloodbath Beyond Podcast. Scares everybody, and welcome to the second episode of Bloodbath Beyond Podcast. I'm your host, William Pattison, King of Splatterpunk, and author of the Camp Crystal Lake novels. All right. So, yeah, summer is here. I can feel it. Oh, my fucking God. Yeah, I can feel it all right. Because I'm sitting here in my room and it is 95 degrees in here. I've got the fan on and it's doing next to nothing. So I'm sitting here sweating like a pig in here. But you know what? I'm here for you. And this show is here for you guys. So I will suffer for you. Anyways, yeah. So, you know, since I saw you, a lot of things are happening, and I couldn't be happier. Of course, you know, you guys know about dear old Johnny Depp and Amber Turd, and the fact that Johnny won! Amber got $2 million, but Johnny got $15. Also, believe it or not, Disney has got on their knees and begged Johnny to come back, and Johnny told them, oh, well, you're going to have to pay, and they are paying whatever Johnny wants, because Johnny is wanted back as Jack Sparrow, because none of the fans will go see their fucking movie if they don't have Johnny Depp as Jack Sparrow. You know, they should have been smarter than that rather than siding with Amber Turd. You know, and yes, I know the woke members of the fandom or anti-fandom will be sitting there going, how dare you talk about a woman like that? Well, the woman lied. The woman lied. The woman brutalized dear old Johnny Depp, who is a gentleman. So, screw you, Amber. Yeah, you go ahead and appeal, but you're going to lose again. You're going to lose. Because all of those tapes show you for who you are. Also, you know, just to stay in D.C. territory, because, of course, Amber Heard's supposedly has had her part in Aquaman 2 taken down to a little cameo. And supposedly, in one scene, she's going to be replaced by a talking dolphin. I love that. Talking dolphin. Anyways, yeah, from what I'm hearing, Black Superman is a thing of the past because they want Henry Cavill back. They want Henry Cavill as Superman. They are going to restart the Snyderverse, which I'm absolutely happy about. And there is talks of them getting rid of J.J. Abrams. You know, as much as I do like what J.J. Abrams did with Star Trek, yeah, I was okay with the Kelvin's universe. It was okay. It was, you know, it was enjoyable. But, you know, now I've got Strange New Worlds, which is better. But anyways, yeah, JJ really got up my nose and the nose of a lot of DC fans when he was deciding that he's going for Black Constantine. You fucking asshole. No. No. I can accept Keanu Reeves up to a point, but the person who needs to be Constantine and everyone, all the people who buy your fucking tickets, Warner Brothers, they want Matt Ryan. Why the fuck are you pulling this shit? Why the fuck aren't you giving us the Constantine that we want? We want the Constantine from the comic books. We don't want Black Constantine. We don't want this, this guy that J.J. Abrams is trying to throw down our throat. You know, it's as bad as Neil Gaiman cutting Constantine out of Sandman. I was really pissed off. I don't mind Joanna Constantine because she was in it, but substituting her for John Constantine is fucked up, people. It is royally fucked up, and I didn't appreciate it. You know, it's just as bad as what they're going to be doing with James Bond. They already killed James Bond. In the last film, James Bond was dead. He was dead. So, why the hell are you trying to get Ibris as James Bond? Give me a fucking break, people. Stop it. Stop it. You want to bring James Bond back? Bring James Bond back right. Stop fucking with things. I'm getting real tired of this woke shit. Let me tell you something about woke. That people do not, you know, these woke assholes do not want to understand is the fact that woke is not about equality and inclusion. Woke is about taking away from one group to give to another group. And to sit there and villainize the group that you are taking shit from. That is what woke is. Woke has nothing to do with equality. It has nothing to do with it. And the way the woke ones are fucking with history and all that, you know, Ray Bradbury wrote about it in Fahrenheit 451. That's the world that we're building there. Why don't we listen to Gene Roddenberry and stop this crap? And I don't mean modern Star Trek. I mean the Gene Roddenberry philosophy that he wanted, really, which was equality. He wanted racism ended. He wanted people not to be villainized. That is what we should be striving for, people. That is what we should be striving for. Taking away people, you know, taking away our icon, you know, the white male's icons is not right. No. taking away white people's icons is not right. No, it is not right. So anyways, yeah, this is going to be hopefully the last time that I ever get political on this. But I needed to say something. I royally needed to say something. You know, people call me the Harlan Ellison of Friday the 13th for good reason. Because I have opinions. And I usually have my opinions from, you know, knowing shit rather than being idiots and just going by a gut reaction. No, seriously. Oh, well, you're just an angry man, William, and you're a cis male. Bullshit. You just use that as an excuse because you don't want to hear an opposing opinion. Grow up. Everyone has an opposing opinion. Once we stop having opposing opinions and once that right is given, you know, taken away, that is when we are fucking doomed as a society. So just learn something, people. Learn something and remember, go woke, go broke. And Warner Brothers, you need to fucking listen to that because you are fucking yourselves over. Get a clue. You know, it's hard enough to make a fucking movie without you guys fucking it up even worse. You know, with this woke crap. Anyways, alrighty, so tonight, it's amazing. I go from politics to actually something fun to talk about. You know, yeah. Oh boy, tonight's movie that I'm going to be talking about is one of the last films that was done through Charles Band's Empire Pictures. It was one of the few. I mean, there was before he moved on and started Full Moon Pictures. And this one was a film directed by one of the really good filmmakers that would eventually actually do a series for Full Moon Pictures. And that director is Ted Nicolai. Ted is the writer of our movie that I'm going to be talking about. TerrorVision! Yes, indeed. TerrorVision is a sci-fi comedy. Sci-fi horror comedy, I should say. Written and directed by Nicolau. Ted it absolutely loves sci-fi films from the 1950s and that. You know, the stuff that inspired Mars Attacks and that kind of thing. You know, films like Invasion of the Saucer Men and Invaders from Mars. You know, or, of course, one of my favorites, Plan 9 from Outer Space. Yeah. Yeah, he really loves stuff like that, just like I do. I, you know, Ted is very much like me when it comes to his love of films. And this one is just a love letter to fans of those type of films. Anyway, so the plot on this is cool as hell. It is the 80s. And, well, actually, let's actually start out from the opening of the film, because that is absolutely cool. You have an alien landscape, including, and I find this hilarious, an upside-down primary and secondary hull of a model of the Starship Enterprise from Star Trek the Motion Picture. Yeah, supposedly this is the planet Pluto. And what you see is you see a classic 1950s style alien, you know, the kind of ones with the pointy ears and stuff. And there's this other creature, it's behind a glass, circular glass piece. And the alien is hitting some controls on this very low-tech looking machine. I mean, seriously, it's a piece of plexiglass with paint on it, with blinky lights behind it, and the control is this little switch that, you know, one of those big long ones that you have to pull back, like the Star Trek transporter ones. Anyways, he does that. There's smoke effects. And this creature in there, this creature is huge. And it's got these eyes, and it's got this big-ass mouth. And anyways, yeah, you know, Beekler does a wonderful job on the special effects. I love Beekler's work every time he does it. I mean, shit, everybody loves his zombie Jason, you know, that Kane Hodder was Kane Hodder's first Jason. Anyways, and some of his other works, and this is pretty cool. So anyways, what happens is he pulls the switch, there's smoke effects, and then all you see is this beam go and hit the primary hull, or hit the saucer section of the Enterprise, and then shoot off, and it goes and goes doink, doink, doink from around different planets. Yeah, bouncing off different planets. And that's where the opening credits come in. Okay, now after the opening credits, we are introduced to the Putterman family. Oh my God. The dysfunctional Putterman family. And the first person, the first Putterman we see is the master of the family, Mr. Stanley Putterman. Oh my fucking God. This guy is a geeky looking one, and you can tell that he's a narcissistic little pube. He's this geeky looking guy, and he's wearing, you know, it's the 1980s. and he's wearing the John Travolta, you know, Miami Vice outfits, you know, the white coat, white pants, white shoes, and pink button-down shirt. Oh, my God. I was from the 80s, and fuck that. I would not wear that shit if you asked me to. Oh, God. God. God, I hated 80s attire. You know, I never had the haircut. I never had the big hair. I always had shortcut hair. God. I did go through a turtleneck phase during that time, but, you know, that was about it, you know. But I got the turtleneck phase from watching The Prisoner. So, yeah, geeky turtleneck guy. That was me. Anyways, yeah, so Mr. Putterman, Stanley, is working on a satellite dish. Yeah, a at-home satellite dish. Now, the satellite guy from the satellite company, Norton, he's trying to tell Stanley, okay, Stanley, you know, I really don't like these Type 100s. And Stanley is going, oh, no, you know, I'm going to make this the best satellite dish in town. You know, that's just how it's going to be. And he's sitting there tinkering with this thing, and smoke's coming out of it and stuff. And all of a sudden, you see, like, a meteorite coming. It's the signal from Pluto, and it hits the satellite dish, and it knocks Stanley and Norton on their asses. And all of a sudden, they're seeing stuff, but in the house, Stanley's wife
Raquel Putterman.
She was watching one of those really amusing 80s exercise video, you know, where the girls are in a circle and they're swinging their butts at you. Yeah, and all of a sudden it's gone. Her daughter, Susie Putterman, played by Diane Franklin, a girl that everyone will remember from Amityville Horror 2. She played the older sister in it. She shows just how good a parent Stanley and Raquel are. Yeah, Susie is a full-on punk rocker with fucking multicolored hair, you know, pins all over the place, big old skirt with pants. I think it's pants or their pantyhose or whatever, but they got holes in them and stuff. And she comes in and she's giving her mom a bad time because she missed the noodles video on MTV, I gather. So anyways, and she's going, oh, God, you know, your father is
messing around with the satellite dish again. And like, oh no. And then we are introduced to the son, Sherman Putterman, and Grandpa Putterman. Now, Sherman, you know, obviously it's Grandpa who's raised him, because Grandpa is one of these survivalist end of the world psychos. Grandpa actually lives in the basement of the house, which he's converted into a bomb shelter. And Grandpa has got this place filled, I mean literally filled, with explosives, machine guns, pistols, survival rations and stuff. And, you know, Grandpa has his workstation where he makes his living. And Grandpa, what he does is he uses lizards and he chops off their tails and he turns them into lizard jerky that he sells on the street. And of course, you know, because it's a lizard, the tails grow back. So he's got an unending supply of jerky that he sells. You know, he's ex-military and stuff, so you know he's a little bit psychoed in the head, and. Sherman is basically his acolyte. He knows how to shoot guns and stuff, and he eats lizard jerky with his grandpa. And both him and Grandpa love horror films. And their favorite show that they watch is Medusa. And I want to say the character of Medusa is played magnificently by 80s horror maven Jennifer Richards. You know, if Full Moon ever wants to do a reboot where they tell a prequel about Medusa, I can honestly suggest that they use Debbie Rochon for the role, because yeah, I mean, when I watched the movie here, I could see very, very much Debbie Rochon vibes. And anyways, yeah, so Medusa is this snarky, I mean, really snarky Elvira parody, except that she's very nasty and, you know, just snarky, rotten person. Anyway, so the thing is that Stanley is showing off his work on the satellite dish. And the what we start seeing, you know, they keep intercutting the picture of the back of the satellite dish. And the thing is that the satellite dish is starting to get green ooze coming out of it. And anyways, on the screen, what happens is that they see the creature from the beginning of the film. They see him on the screen. It's sitting there going, but anyways, and they think, oh, well, it's just another horror movie. And then it fades into Medusa. So they think it's part of the show. Anyways, Grandpa and Sherman, they go and they decide to watch horror films. You know, Stanley doesn't like horror films, but Grandpa tells him, no, horror films are fantastic. You know, just like war films, you know, they're survival oriented. So they're great. They're great entertainment. They teach you how to survive. And I honestly agree with you on that. That's definitely a truthful thing about horror movies. Anyway, so Grandpa and Sherman go and are watching Medusa. Stanley and Raquel, they go out because they're going to go and have dinner and visit, you know, have over guests because they're swingers and they want to swing, and they put in a believe it or not, put in an ad on eBay, and they found a couple, a guy named Spiro, who is played amazingly by Alexandra Ray, who, if you don't know Alexandro, he was the priest in the television series The Flying Nun. He also played in the TV horror movie Satan's Triangle. Yeah, he played a priest in that as well. He was the devil pretending to be a priest. Well, anyways, he plays Spiro. And his girlfriend is named Cherry. Now, Cherry sounds like Harley Quinn. Seriously. She has a, oh, Mr. J voice. And she's a blonde, blue-eyed. She's a ditzy blonde. And she's one that has done porno movies. And she's done horror films. How we know about that is because all of a sudden on the TV, when they arrive, I'm getting a little ahead of myself. Stanley takes them to the love room. Yeah, it's the love area for the house. Oh man, I haven't even told you about the house. The house is this horrible mix of stuff, and all the chairs are square. I mean, literally square chairs with red cushions on them. Even the couch is painted white, and it's square, and it's got red cushions. And on the walls of this place are these horribly tacky impressionist paintings. I mean, literally, oh God. And then Greek and Roman statues all over the place. So anyways, the love room has a huge pool in it. And in the love room, there is also a television. Believe it or not, they actually have a television in the swinger room. You know, it's the love room is right next to their bedroom. Quite literally right next door to the bedroom. Anyways, on the screen is the alien from the other alien. The alien that shot this alien to Earth. And he's out there and he's begging the humans, shut down your satellites, shut off your TV screens, shut off all communication devices, anything that can pick up a signal. You know, the future of your world depends on it, because a creature has been sent to your planet, and if you don't, it will eat all of you humans. And the message keeps going and going, and anyways, Cherry goes and she goes, I think I read for this, you know, for this movie. My God, they were assholes. It's hilarious. But anyways, to cut this down a little bit so I don't make my discussion, you know, as long as the damn movie. What ends up happening is Spiro and Candy, you know, Stanley did not realize the fact that when he was asking in his ad for people who liked Greek, that in the swinger world, the people who really liked Greek were people who were into same-sex swinging. So Spiro is interested in doing Stanley. And he wants his wife, well, girlfriend, Candy, to do Raquel. And he kind of makes it clear, there's little indications, because he's asking Stanley, so Stanley, are you a man's man? And he goes, of course I'm a man's man, look at me, you know, I'm a man's man. Yes, I can see it. You are a man's man. He goes, yeah, why were you asking me anyways? He goes, well, you realize, Stanley, I am Greek. And he's like, Okay. I don't get it. But anyways, ends up that Raquel finds out from Candy what's going on, and you know, she finds out from Spiro himself. He goes, "No, I am Greek," you know, because she tries to make a pass at him. He goes, "You realize I am Greek. I am into boys." And he goes, "Your husband Stanley, he's a man's man." And Raquel's like, "Oh God." And so she goes to tell Stanley. Anyways, they're gone, Cherry decides to go into the pool. And while she's gone, it appears the Hungry Beast came in and gobbled her up. Now, the thing is that the Hungry Beast, yeah, that's what it's called, the Hungry Beast. What it can do is when it eats somebody, it can regurgitate their head and use it as a puppet, as a lure. So Spiro thinks that Candy is at the end of the pool waiting for him. And, you know, Spiro is actually bisexual, so he wants to have a quickie before he has a little Stanley. So he goes in and he's coming in into the, and he feels something in the water. It's this jelly stuff. Literally, it's the remainder of Cherry. But he thinks it's love lotion or something, some kind of lubricant, sexual lubricant that they put in the pool. So he comes, when he gets up to her, all of a sudden he's like, "Ugh!" Because the Hungry Beast starts eating him. So anyways, Raquel and Stanley come back, and the Hungry Beast comes out of the television and goes after them. So they get eaten by the Hungry Beast. I skipped a killing. Norton actually gets eaten by the Hungry Beast first, because he comes to try to fix the satellite dish. And he just sits there and he sees all this goop coming out of the thing. He goes, "Oh, I hate the 100s. And the Hungry Beast comes up behind him and eats him. Well, anyways, what happens is that Sherman and Grandpa have fallen asleep in front of the TV, and Grandpa wakes up and the creature comes out of the television and eats him, and his scream wakes up Sherman. Sherman sees the monster eating Grandpa and runs to Grandpa's place, you know, and locks himself in, because that's what you're supposed to do in the emergency. That's what Grandpa taught him. So anyways, you know, he's stays in there. Before Raquel and Stanley you know, get killed. The thing is, when they arrive with Spiro and Cherry, what ends up happening is that Sherman comes out and he's trying to tell them about the monster. And Raquel and the father are just sitting there rolling their eyes and they're saying, yeah, he has issues to Cherry and Spiro. And Raquel goes and locks him in the bomb shelter. Supposedly with Grandpa, because the thing has, you know, regurgitates Dad, Grandpa's head, and has it looking around the corner at them, and he's going, oh yeah, I'm just doing business. That's what it says. It can actually talk. Oh yeah, I'm just doing business. Okay, yeah, that's cool. Leave him. And Sherman knows that that's not Grandpa. He knows that that's the monster trying to trick him. And he goes and he runs to one of Grandpa's lockers that he's got and pulls out an AK-47. This little kid's holding an AK-47 and he's he trying to hold off the hungry beast, which has actually ended up jumping back into the television. But anyways, he decides he needs to call somebody, so he calls the police, and he ends up with Police Officer Nutkey, who is played by Ian Patrick Williams. And Nutkey is sitting there going, excuse me, it's Saturday night. You know, we've got a small police force and we can't. Do you know that putting in a false report is against the law? And you can get arrested? And he said, you know, don't call here again, or I'm going to come down there and I'm going to put you in jail. So anyways, yeah, so Simon hangs up thinking that he's, oh my God. Yeah, I've dealt with police officers and yeah, I get a lot of that attitude from them. Oh my God. You know, a lot of the cops in this area are a bunch of jackasses. Anyways, so Nutkey doesn't work out, but he decides to call the only other person that he can think of to call. And it's because Medusa is on the screen and she takes calls. She has a segment where she takes calls from viewers. Anyway, so Sherman calls her and she's like, yeah, okay. And she's like, you know, give me a break, kid. You know, and he's going, yeah, there's a monster in my house. You know, he killed Grandpa and stuff. And he goes, oh, really? Are you on medication, son? Yeah, that's what she says. Are you on medication? And anyways, so she hangs up on him. And she goes and the television screen pulls into her face. And she goes, Sherman, Sherman. And then this monster face goes, shoo! And Sherman jumps backwards and she laughs and she goes, have a nice night, Sherman. Anyway, so at that point, his sister Sally and her new boyfriend. Oh God. Her new boyfriend, Odie, or Susie. I keep calling her Sally. Susie shows up with her new boyfriend, Odie, metal rocker. I mean, seriously, oh my God, this guy looks like he's on drugs. He looks like his brain's been fried. He's got this big old long hair, leather outfit. He's got a gauntlet on his arm and stuff. He's, you know, and she ended up, she had to introduce him to her mom and dad because they insisted. And they were like, oh my God. And he's like, oh, hi, Mr. Putterman. Oh, nice to meet you, sir. You know, just doing the typical, you know, and it's like, okay, nobody's believing this shit. You know, that you're trying to pull, trying to be the nice guy. Yeah, he's in a metal band and stuff. You know, lead guitarist and singer and stuff. Yeah, oh my fucking God. Anyway, so Susie comes back with OD! And Sherman has blown the door off of the bomb shelter so that he can get out. He tells Susie and OD about what's going on, and they're laughing their asses off. They walk into the living room, and the Hunger Beast comes out of the television. It starts going for OD, and OD holds his gauntlet up, and the monster freezes because OD's gauntlet looks exactly like the gauntlet that its master used to have. So it's thinking that OD is its master, returned. And so, Susie, OD, you know, I mean, the mass, you know, the unbelievable intelligence group here, Susie, OD, and Sherman come to a plan that they're going to pull a ET thing, because of course ET had just come out, and they were going to try to get this alien monster out to the public. They start teaching it to talk. Like, it can say Susie, it can say OD. When it says Sherman, it pukes. Anyways, what ends up happening is the Medusa show ends, and you know, the monster's getting agitated because it's been watching TV. It likes TV. You know, they earlier in the movie they show it TV, they show it food, but it doesn't like their food. You know, it likes to eat people. It doesn't like their kind of food, that doesn't like donuts or any of that shit. But anyways, Medusa turns off and it's getting agitated. OD tries to change the channel to different stuff, and it doesn't like any of that stuff. And all of a sudden, OD gets angry and he pops it. He hits it on the head. And this angers the hungry beast and it eats OD. And Susie and Sherman run out. They try to go, you know, oh my God, we got to save mom and dad. And they find the hungry beast goes and moves to their mom and dad's bedroom. And it starts bringing up all the heads, you know, and they're going, you know, they got Spiro, they got Cherry, they got, you know, a Stanley and Raquel. And they're all in bed and they go, oh, where's Grandpa? And all of a sudden, Grandpa's head appears up between the two. Oh, I'm just doing business, guys. I'm just doing business. And so they run away. They start getting themselves armed. And, you know, things go from bad to worse. Stanley. Oh, before that point, they call Medusa, and they invite her to come to their party and meet the monster. You know, they figure that she has, you know, carte blanche when it comes to, you know, entertainment and stuff. So they figure, okay, well, you know, and she goes, oh, really? It's going to be a good party, eh? Okay, I'll come. Well, anyway, so what ends up happening is she's on her way. The policeman from the other time, he shows up. He gets eaten by the hungry beast. And at this moment, the person that, you know, the alien from the beginning of the alien from the beginning of the movie, the guy who was supposed to get rid of the hunger beast, Pluthar, shows up. He's in a spacesuit that looks right out of the 50s, and he's holding a laser gun that looks like something out of those paintings with the aliens with the round, fish tank on their heads. Yeah, with the big backpack on the back and stuff in silver. Yeah, he shows up and the kids find out that mom and dad are dead, that they've been eaten by the hunger beast. And Pluthar tells them that, you know, if they can capture the Hunger Beast alive, that they can pull the human DNA from the Hunger Beast and regrow all the people that have been eaten. The only problem is that they'll have to live the rest of their lives in fish tanks because of this. Like, okay, whatever. Well, anyways, what ends up happening is that Medusa shows up. She sees Pluthar, and he's talking to the kids, and they're putting down their guns. And he's got, you know, well, he's still got his, big gun. And she goes up behind him, and she hits his fish tank with it and cracks it. So he's sitting there, he's losing pressure, and his head explodes. Literally explodes, and he dies. And they're like, oh my God, yo, oh my God, what did you do, you bitch? You just killed him. And she's going, well, I tried saving the day for you. What, you know, what's your problem? So anyways, the Hungry Beast busts through the wall in the living room and starts using this tongue of its to use suction. And, yeah, and everyone's ends up being eaten by the Hungry Beast. Well, the movie ends with the Hungry Beast. He comes up and he gets into the back of the limo that's waiting for Medusa. And he's got the Medusa head, but it's only half formed. And she goes, come on, you know, let's get back to the studio. And it's like, whoa. And that's the end of the movie. So, yeah, this is a funny-ass movie. It's wonderful. You know, me just discussing it and telling it. You know, I mean, Beekler does a beautiful job on the special effects on this. The set work is good, even though it's tacky as shit. You know, it's meant to be tacky as shit. Oh, God. And the acting is really good for what they had to deal with in regard to the type of characters. And so, you know, I mean, seriously, this film is fantastic. If you like 50s style sci-fi invasion films like that, you'll love TerrorVision. It is, as I said, it is a love note to those type of films. And anyways, on my scale for films, I will give this one a definite 5 because I love this. And this is a wonderful film that is at the point where, you know, Empire's going out and Charles Band is moving over to Full Moon. This has a lot of the feel of a Full Moon thing. And what happened is after it got put on Full Moon for a while, you know, it got distributed through Full Moon when it was, you know, when Full Moon was being distributed through Paramount Pictures, you know, along with a few films from Empire. So anyways, so yeah, that's TerrorVision. And now it is time for our music break. So I'll catch you in a little while. I got a nice selection of music for you. I hope you really enjoy it. Catch you in a little bit.
Surprise! Do you believe in me? Could be the fear that's everywhere. Moon don't look friendly. There's a blood in the sky. But I taste a sweat burning. Getting ready. You think they're insane? In the street night's coming, and they'll never be the same. Look out for the darkness. Hold on to your soul. It's a call of the wild, and it's a call of the road. Hollow of the night. The streets are calling, stealing from the light. The shadows are calling. It's the power. Thank you.
Thank you for calling USA in Prime Credit. My name is Peggy.
What is problem, please?
Peggy? Sure. Well, suddenly it looks like I'm being charged
a $35 annual fee.
Yes?
Tell me it's a mistake.
Yes?
Are you saying yes? Are you asking yes?
Yes.
Peggy?
Peggy?
Want better customer service? Switch to Discover. Rank number one in customer loyalty. It pays to Discover.
Hello, my she-devils and demons. This is Nurse Hatchet, she-wolf of the wolf pack.
What's that you're really stirring in your tea? Honey or bee vomit? Animal secretions that make us say yum. Coming up on Sick Sad World. Alrighty, welcome to the second half of the show. You know, this is where we have all the fun stuff here. The real fun stuff. Yeah, you know, we are talking horror merchandise. That's right. With our horror memorabilia news. I've spent the entire month running around the internet looking for this stuff. Just for you, because that's what this show is for. It's for you. So, let's check this out. First off, Alternate Endings has released Japanese-inspired A Nightmare on Elm Street 2, Freddy's Revenge Apparel. The line includes t-shirts for $26, long sleeves for $36, sweatpants for $39, and hats for $25. Orders will ship in 4 to 6 weeks. And these look cool. These are very colorful. Nightmare on Elm Street 2 is in Japanese. And, you know, they got a Red Freddy on there. You know, there's like slashes and stuff. It's looks fantastic. Definitely check it out. Go to alternate ending and check it out. All right. So, next, Super 7 has revealed its second wave of Toho Ultimates, which includes Godzilla from Godzilla vs. Destroyer and Mechagodzilla from Godzilla vs. Mechagodzilla 2. Expected shipping is in summer 2023. They're available for pre-order for $85 each. Godzilla is 8 inches tall and 14 inches long. It comes with 2 interchangeable heads, 6 interchangeable hands, and 4 attachable smoke effects. Mega Godzilla is 9 inches tall and 5.5 long. It comes with 3 interchangeable heads, 4 interchangeable hands, alternate stomach plate, Gardua jet, 2 forearm tasers, and 2 attachable jet thruster effects. Cool. Bloodbath Broke Horror Fan presents Summer of 1984 on limited edition, fully functional VHS. Their latest tape is now at Whittier Entertainment. The 2018 horror film arrives on VHS in a black clamshell case with three versions to choose from, a standard edition with new art by Chris Barnes, 50 stocked, a variant with the theatrical art by Francis Simard, limited to 50, and a big box edition with Bernard's art and a red VHS tape, limited to 50. Each tape includes exclusive introductions by actor Caleb Emery and writers Matt Leslie and Stephen J. Smith. Stay tuned for the movie, after the movie, for a special feature, the blooper reel. Love that. For optimal VHS viewing, the film has been cropped from its original aspect ratio to 4.3 full frame. It is officially licensed from Gunpowder and Sky and has been approved by directors Francis Simard, Anouk Wissalel, and Joanna Carl Whistle. Yeah, looks good. They have two variants. One is a poster art with all the characters on it. And the other one is a milk carton with a skull-faced boy with a missing message on it. Grab a new zombie shirt featuring its alternate British title, Zombie Flesh Eaters, from Gutter Garb for $28, designed by Mr. Black. It is scheduled to ship the week of June 26th. Okay, in honor of PG's love for hunky boys, Raven Banner has released a Pride edition of PG Psycho Gorman on Blu-ray, priced at $25. It comes with a limited edition slipcover art with art by Elze Martin, written and directed by Stephen Kosansky, who did The Void and Leprechaun Returns. The 2020 sci-fi horror comedy features Nita Jose Hanna, Owen Meyer, Adam Brooks, Alexis Carza Harze, and Matthew Nimabar as Psycho Gorman. The set features the Canadian Blu-ray, which offers more special features than the U.S. edition. Fright Rags delivers a tribute to Honey, Joe Bob Briggs' original male girl from Monster Vision, with a shirt designed by Kyle Crawford. It's $28. So go check that out at Fright Rags. Art the Clown parodies Batman the Killing Joke on Terror Threads Terrifier, designed by Yannick Bouchard. Scheduled to ship the week of June 26th. It is available on t-shirts for $30 and tank tops for $32. In celebration of Creepshow's 40th anniversary, NECA will release the Creep Ultimate Action Figure in September. It's available for pre-order for $34.99. It stands 7 inches tall and has over 25 points of articulation and has a fabric robe with a wire armature for posing. 3 interchangeable heads, Creepshow comic pumpkin, and candle are included. It's packaged in a window box with an open flap. Yeah, this is cool. It is the original Creep from the movie Creepshow. It's not the new Creep that we see on the television show. So this one's going to be cool. I'm definitely going to be putting in for that. Alrighty, and finally, NECA is turning Predator 2's Boar Predator into an ultimate action figure. Due out in September, the 7-scale toy is available to pre-order for $39.99. It has over 30 points of articulation, including and includes 2 interchangeable heads, masked and unmasked, extending and collapsing spears, shoulder cannon with attachable blast effect, trophy necklace, chest armor, and more. It's packaged in a window box with an open flap. Alrighty, so that is it for merchandise. Now it is time for Scream Factory new releases, and I know you guys are looking forward to this. Alrighty, first off, and this is, you know, there's only 2 sets of movies this month. It's amazing. But anyways, first off, we have the Funhouse Collector's Edition with exclusive poster. Yes, indeed. Order from Scream Factory. Well, I should say shoutfactory.com, and get an exclusive 18x24 rolled poster, including the original theatrical artwork, available while supplies last. Extras are in process and will be announced at a later date. Okay, so let's get to that synopsis. Synopsis: the Funhouse really excels as Hooper takes excellent advantage of the setting. Plus, it's got a terrific twist with its killer that makes it one worth seeking out. Charles Webb, MTV. Director Tobe Hooper, The Texas Chainsaw Massacre, and Life Force pays affectionate tribute to various classic horror movies in this tale of 2 teenage couples who spend the night in a sleazy carnival funhouse. On her first date with Buzz, Amy disobeys her father and goes to the carnival with Richie and Liz. But their first date may end up as their last after witnessing a murder. The four terrified teens are trapped in the maze of the funhouse and stalked by a real monster, a horribly deformed killer who lurks among the freakish exhibits to butcher them one by one. Also starring Sylvia Miles, Midnight Cowboy, Kevin Conway, Invincible, from the Invincibles, in three roles. The Funhouse features special makeup designed by the ingenious Rick Baker, American Werewolf in London, and Ed Wood. Yes, love that movie. Alrighty, so anyways, yeah. Scream Factory is going nuts. Literally nuts. With child's play movies. They have released the first three child's play movies, which, you know, most people think are the best of the series, in special collector's edition with exclusive posters. And, it's absolutely cool. They are individual or they are in sets. And I want to definitely tell you about the combined bundle editions. Alright, I gotta get down to this. I'm on the website. Here we go. They've got two different sets that you can go for. And these will be out August 16th, 2022. Oh, actually, there's three of them. Okay, you have a version with all three movies, five posters, and two slip covers, and that's for $113.94. Okay, the second one is for $153. And this one includes everything that I said before. The three movies, the slip covers, the posters, but it also includes a NECA exclusive burned Chucky figure that you can get. Yeah, this is a NECA exclusive for Scream Factory. And the final one, the Big Mama collection, is you get the three movies, you get the slip covers, you get the posters, you get crispy, crunchy Chucky, and you get a set of enamel pins. Isn't that cool? And that's for $210. Yeah, these are UHD and Blu-ray. So, and also finally, you also, if you just want the crispy fried Chucky doll, you can get that. Yeah. You can get Mr. Crispy Fried Chucky. The doll is $39.99. And I know that if you are like me and a Chucky fan who likes to collect the figures, you're going to want this. This is a once-in-a-lifetime possibility to actually get this exclusive Chucky figure. I mean, seriously, you're gonna want this because it looks awesome. It looks exactly like Chucky at the end of Child's Play when he's come out of the fireplace. Oh man, he looks good. They did a good job on this. So yeah, you Chucky fans, you're gonna want this. This is a definite, you know. But you know, if you have the money, as I said, I'd get the collector's edition movies and get yourself the one with the Chucky doll and the enamel pins. Though that looks like an awesome one because they got just tons and tons and tons of extras on these. This is, you know, these, you know, they got everything on here. They got interviews, they got documentaries, they got all kinds of shit. I mean, it is just overwhelming if you're a Chucky fan. Alrighty, so that was it for Scream Factory. Hopefully they'll get us some more stuff for next month, you know, because I mean seriously, I would like to see more DVDs. You know, I mean, yes, I do love when they bring out the collector's editions. I do love the collector's editions, but I'd also like to see other stuff as well. Alrighty, so now it is time for our final segment, which is, of course, movie reviews. And I know you guys are excited to hear about what I've watched and what I thought about them. First one, and, you know, I can tell you that all three of these films you can find on Tubi TV. I was doing a Tubi TV thing, and that's where I grabbed and watched all of these. And it was awesome. Okay, our first, it's actually a shorter piece. It's really a web series that was edited together to make it feature length. And it's not really even feature length. It's 51 minutes. But this is actually worth talking about. This is Dragon Age Redemption, which was a project done by my dear friend Felicia Day. Oh my God. You know, Felicia is a fantastic producer and stuff. Her web series have always come out beautifully. I mean, if you remember her blockbuster web series, The Guild, think of the quality of that. But I mean, she has actually taken the RPG Dragon Age and created an original movie based on the Dragon Age universe. And, this thing was created by Felicia Day, and she stars in it. And, it's about an elf character who is kind of a bounty hunter type character. You wouldn't actually think of Felicia Day being a bounty hunter or that. But Felicia Day does a fantastic job in this, and she actually shows herself as a competent stunt fighter, because of course, with the budget that she had, she didn't have money for a lot of heavy duty stunt people. So pretty much the actors had to do their own stunts. But, and the thing is that she uses her budget fantastically. I mean, the sets look good. The characters look pretty good. I'm amused by the fact that Felicia had the elf ears, real long elf ears, amazingly long elf ears, and anyways, it's a story about this elf that is trying to redeem herself to the guild. When we actually meet her, she is basically cutting up meat for prisoners. That's what it is. And anyways, her master gives her, he's a demon-like one, and he gives her the job of locating this dragon mask and these artifacts before an evil demon can grab them up and open a doorway for the ultimate evil. And so Felicia gets together a quest group, and she has a Templar, she has a half-demon lady who can be either human or demon, and she has a magical elf. Felicia is a warrior elf. The other elf is a magical elf. And so they have to go through all this different stuff and try to grab these pieces before the evil demon can open the gateway.
really good stuff. I love the work on it. I think honestly somebody should give Felicia a full-on movie to direct. I mean, I've seen her in other movies. I remember her fondly from her movie Red, where she played a werewolf hunting Red Riding Hood. And she kicked butt in that movie. And of course, you know, her work on Buffy the Vampire Slayer, she was good in that. But this time she was playing a warrior, and amazingly enough, she was convincing in this role. So, Oogie Boogie Scale for Dragon Age Redemption, I give it a 4.5. And honestly, I'm telling you, go check it out on Tubi TV. You won't be disappointed. It's a wonderful mini movie. I didn't even know that they actually did that on Tubi TV, but they did. And I was pleasantly surprised. Alrighty, next movie. If you really like Harry Potter, you'll probably like this one. It's a movie I found on Tubi that was called The Last Dragon Slayer. And this movie tells the story of a young muggle. Yeah, I'll call her a muggle because she's a human being who is in this world, this fantasy world where magic is in control of everything. You know, pretty much everybody is a witch or has magical powers in some way, and muggles are very rare. You know, it's kind of a reversal of Harry Potter in that witches that were a lot less in society. But in this fantasy world, magic is starting to be superseded by technology. And this girl who was orphaned, she lives in this famous magician's house. The magician has disappeared, and she accidentally gets stuck because the town wants her to be the dragon slayer. Really, what they want to do is they want her to be killed, for a good laugh. So they make her the next dragon slayer. People have been massacred by the dragons whenever they try to kill the last dragon, because they figure they kill the last dragon and it will end magic. So anyways, yeah, she's caught in a conflict of interest, and she's trying to find the man that raised her with the family that she's made in this house.
You know, as I said, if you really love Harry Potter films, you will love this. This film is actually based on a book series called, a book series called The Chronicles of Kazam. And The Last Dragon Slayer is the first book in this series. It's a shame that, this movie didn't get a lot of viewership. And so it's the rest of the series wasn't made. You know, it's kind of like what happened with that other one that actually became a television series later on and got the rest of the story done. My Darkly or something. But anyways, this one's one that should be redone as a television series, and then it would probably turn out, because a lot of people like this kind of Harry Potter style stuff, and I really liked it. I thought it was really good. I thought the dragon sucked. The CGI on the dragon really sucked. But everything else about it was really good. The characters, I really liked the characters, and I liked the actors. And that, they were all really good. So, once again, I'm going to give this movie, The Last Dragon Slayer, a 4.5 on the Oogie Boogie scale. Alrighty, and now we come to our last film that you can also find on, guess where? Tubi TV. And it is a 1991 film called Highway to Hell. Okay. Anyways, storyline. Charlie Sykes and his girlfriend Rachel Clark are traveling to Vegas to secretly get married. They decide to follow through a secondary road while fueling their car at Sam's Last Chance gas station. They are advised by the owner and attendant Sam not to sleep after the second tree in the road. They fall asleep in the car, and a policeman arrests Rachel. Charlie returns to the gas station, and Sam tells him that she has been arrested by a hell cop, and he has to go to hell if he wants to rescue his fiance. Okay, so basically, what we've got is we've got a rewriting of Dante's Inferno about a guy who has to go after his true love in hell. Try to get his true love back in hell. And this one is kind of a combination action comedy thing. I mean, seriously, you got three members of the Stiller family in this film. And they all appear in this one segment where in hell, Charlie ends up going to a coffee shop in hell. Because hell is this big desert area, and believe it or not, they have biker gangs. They have townships. They even have a mechanic who Charlie does not realize is actually Beelzebub himself. And everyone takes the main road to hell for punishment. And the thing is that Beelzebub likes Rachel, and he wants to make her his Hell Queen. So what ends up happening is that Charlie and Rachel end up having to do a race with the Hell Cop to get out of hell. If they get out of hell, Beelzebub will let them free. If not, Rachel is his queen and Charlie gets sent to the torture pit. So much fun. Anyways, yeah, that it was a good movie. I enjoyed it. Unfortunately, this film suffers from the problem that a lot of these type of films do, where they don't know what they are. They really don't know what they are. They try to be funny and they try to be action-packed, and they fail at both. You know, they try to be funny, action-packed, and horrific, and they fail. They royally fail. And, you know, this film was done in the 90s. They didn't have the huge budget and stuff. The special effects were, you know, kind of like the old Empire Pictures, you know, stuff where they have like Mad Max inspired stuff, you know, kind of like Metal Storm Jared Sin type stuff. And honestly, it just didn't fulfill anything of its promise. I loved the Hell Cop, the makeup on the Hell Cop, because the Hell Cop makeup was inspired by Clive Barker's Books of Blood. The main character in Books of Blood, the Book of Blood himself, because this Hell Cop has writing dug into his skin all over his face. It is amusing. Anyways, so let's see, what would I give this one on the Oogie Boogie scale? Honestly, I'll give it a 3. I mean, I enjoyed it up to a point. The comedy seemed out of place. If they had done this as a full serious piece, it would have worked out better. But the thing is, this was the 90s, the early 90s, and people were unsure about horror films. They wanted to add in comedy and that to, in case they had to do with the MMPA. Or the MPPA, whatever the fuck they're called. The jackasses who tell you that you have to edit everything out. You know, that's why, you know, House was made the way it was. Anyways, so, yeah. So that's it for movie reviews. I hope you enjoyed my reviews. You know, I know, you know, and go out and check out these films. Seriously, go out and check these films on Tubi TV because you are missing out. You know, these are some really good movies. You know, you think, oh well, it's a free movie thing. It's all going to be crap movies. No, not always. Anyways, alrighty. Next month, I am proud to present. You know, I am still in the Charlie Band realm. I know. Oh, well, you know, what's this with Charlie Band? Nothing. Charlie Band just is a fantastic low-budget filmmaker, and I like his films. And this film is one that is hard to find now. But luckily, you can find it on Tubi TV. And it is Dark Angel, The Ascent. It's extremely hard. I've been trying to find this film for years, trying to get me another copy of it. It got burned up in my fire years ago, and I really love that film. And it's so hard, you know, it gets expensive, let's put it that way. And most of the time when I find a copy of it, it's in Italian. Because, you know, Charles Band has that wonderful agreement with both Russia and Italy that he will release his films there first and then give it, you know, then send it to us. So most of his films on first release are in Italian. So yeah, next month we have Dark Angel, The Ascent, and then after that we'll have something brand new. Well, not something brand new, but a classic that is not done by Charles Band, but one of my favorites. And I'm not going to tell you anything more about that because spoilers. You're just going to have to wait until next month and go through the show and wait for me to tell you what is going to be the August show. Yep, because August is my birthday month, and that, you know, it's going to be the special one. So, anyway, so be ready for Dark Angel the Ascent. As always, keep America strong, watch horror films, and always remember that this show is done for you. Have yourself a wonderful day. Well, evening, I should say. Alrighty, I'm out of here.
Catch me as I fall. See you're here and it's all over now. Speaking to the atmosphere. No one's here and I fall into myself. This truth drives me into madness. I know I can stop.
Phoenix Comics and Toys. Hello, creeps. Get your one-of-a-kind custom horror host figurines. That's right, kiddies. Or you can find hosts like the Keymaster, Mummy and the Monkey. I just love that name. Mr. Lobo, or even Carlos Borloff's Monster Madhouse. Tell him your bony little friend, the Crypt Keeper, sent you. It won't get you a discount, but it might get you killed. Phoenix Comics and Toys.
Ah!